Organization model for small business growth, which is something we observed across several institutions that we received over the last few months at Capital. And of course, this early lag, what we're going to take you through today is what we think are the key principles of the underlying model. And why this is important for us is to give some context. Those new microfinance industry itself. The microfinance has started off purely with a group model, largely borrowed from the economy and banks' experience in Bangladesh. And beyond the group model, not many MFIs, either in India or in other countries, have looked at what is loan product possibilities or etc. We have had some MFIs in Latin American countries and Africa looking at what they call small business loans, Eastern Europe as well. But their experience has been varied. And the evaluation model that we use has also been varied. It's more data focused, it's more also information and technology focused. Largely similar to the bank association model, also because the kind of businesses that those institutions even in their countries are very different about not India. The media and typically in the same pyramid. You can see a large number of small business entities in the bottom half of the pyramid, which consists about 95% of the total SME space. This is according to data from the Ministry of Business and Annual Report.
What is criteria for that?
The capital investment is less than 5 lakh. So 95% of the business are in this space. And then another 5% of the 5 lakh will be there. 0.1% or less than are in the other key distribution feature of such enterprises from what we see in Europe is that most of the enterprises don't have any written documentation of their income, say, assessment by the bank based on the standard EBGF or other processes in this way. So, we'll take you through what we have observed on the ground, and there might be comments on how the bank organization model is going to be data. This is also something that we're not advocating at this stage. It's really something that we have seen. Across several institutions on the ground. Some of these institutions have been working for the last 10-15 years. Some of them have also started new companies. So, we don't know if this is the right model or what is the possible or if any about. We don't know if there's a better model out there, just a model. So, but some of the key features of the model are what you see on the screen. There's a big balloon here which says that the organization has to be in house. Largely banks use PSAs in India and the world. But most, all the entities that we protect do not use any experience for organization. That may not be the key distinguishing factor, but that is one factor of the interest across the industry. What we believe is that the distinguishing factor is this, the multiple levels of credit check that we do, which is essentially the people who are visiting the customers and doing the detailed cash flow analysis based on personal discussion. In the absence of documented income or sales proof, that's the main level of the last one. And this assessment is supported by local government. Why we are writing this point is, unlike in MFIs, typically in MFIs, it is the policy of many of MFI managers to ensure that the local staff are not from the same region. I think the region is different here, but most MFIs follow this policy, the local staff are not from the same area, university, university, and anything. But here, this is the representation that we saw, that the organization staff as well as the branch manager is from the local area. He may not be from a specific village, which he handles, but he will be from the same. So, for example, if there is a branch in Ahmedabad, he will be from Ahmedabad or from the outskirts, but not from Kashmir. So, the other important principle that we have seen tied to this actually is the strong multi-checker processes in terms of evaluating the cash flows itself. In this respect, again, given the fact that there is a dependence on lack of evidence or lack of documentary evidence, the income that is assessed at one point is checked independently at least at one more point during the process of evaluation. The other key principle that we have seen is separation of business activity. And this typically continues right from the top to the branch level. This again we have already, because this is again typically different from what NFI follows in this one, that the branch manager has the final sanction authority in all loans, irrespective of loan size. That means 14% is the sanction. Now, some NFIs are involved in, or not involved, some NFIs have also started experimenting with involving the area manager, loan manager, in evaluating loans around certain size. But still, the principle there remains the same, that disbursement and transfer can happen at the loan level. Here, one key difference is why that cannot happen is because the loan size is certain to be large. In the economic analysis. And secondly, also in the aspect that you don't have modeled sources of income. Now, this is a new concept that we came across, which will be made for some analysis. The income to installment ratio is something that we have heard of in the economics. But most of these entities have a low income to installment ratio policy. So, what once they have assessed an income, surplus income based on the assessment of business cash flows that they have done, then they apply their IRR policies to that specific case to decide what the maximum loan size can be and also what the time of the loan can be. So, you know, it could be income per month comes out from 10,000 in the policy says that you don't go below 50%, then EMI cannot cross 5,000.
Do we call people that are low income, low income to installment ratio, or what is the criteria for higher?
Typically, the, what we have looked at is 40% to 50%.
40% is natural impact, norm for the housing, which are long term.
Huh.
That's something I am aware about income installment ratio. But what is the low theory? What should be the normal average that
we then. So, if you, for example, if you look at a typical microfinance loan, which is a say a 50,000 loan in installment or something like 20,000, then going by base income estimates of that's 12,000 per month. That's
BPA,
So that's 1,000 by 12,000. 8%. But this is assuming only one MFI in the so if you want to take one or two MFIs, there is a difficulty in this, in this specific customer segment again, is that you don't know how many other non recorded loans this person is doing. So that's again one reason why. Also, the IR that we are talking about is taking into the gross, not on the net of all the expenses.
Is subordinate local authorities influencing factors of IR determination?
Sorry.
Support of local authorities. Is one of the determining factors for low IAR or other? For example, I know that it's in my finance is in first area. I'm just talking about that as a ground.
Yeah.
Those areas are at least in my plenty of MFI property. Or if you look at some low area where probably one MFI property.
No, typically what we have seen on the ground is that the IR policy comes from the
top. Does it have an implication on the number of MFIs operating in the area or just
only source? Because, again, these entities go by recorded or revealed sources of or cash outflows. So if the customer is revealed saying that she is paying something like for a full year or it affects somewhere in the bank statement, only then is it recorded. They don't estimate as such. Based on what we might see on the ground in terms of they also do look at credit bureau. So, the cost that one customer is paying about the credit bureau tax, they look at credit bureau information. But again, across the entities that we have looked at, most of them are invisible and not in the tax stuff. So, we don't know.
Do they offer? Civil, do they offer for these other type of borrowers also?
I mean, typically the database would not have the microfinance borrowers, still would not have
the
database. So, and the other thing is that, except for one or two cases, the customer segment that is being addressed to this, whatever we've seen, is, you know, little different from what we generally have as a microfinance customer. So, they are, you know, maybe, I don't know the right word to use, maybe one level up. As far as the requirements are concerned. So, even if they are covered by, you know, Hanumas or some other microfinance institutions, these guys may not actually be microfinance customers at all. They would actually be customers of the informal lenders, money lenders, and that thing.
What is the typical average loan size?
So, we'll come to that, but I can tell you now, there are certain institutions, again, you know, this market is very, 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 very different from what we see in an MFI, particularly when loan size goes from N to K in our case. See, the market is very varied. There are institutions which are exclusively focusing on doing unsecured lending, and there the loan sizes that we have seen are between the range of 15 to 75,000. There are other institutions which are doing a mix of unsecured as well as secured lending. There the loan size we have seen is starts at somewhere around 30,000 to 60,000 unsecured category, and then starts at 1 lakh and goes up to 10 lakh as the secured category. So this is the kind of variation that we see, but on a general average, we can take something like 1 lakh to 10 lakh. General average. And mostly we will be like that. So, moving ahead, we will take you through the origination process that we have seen. Again, this is only representative of what we have seen in the suggested in the origination process. There are essentially three steps involved in the process. The first is a very basic sourcing and data collection step. The second is the credit appraisal step, which is actually quite detailed. And then, of course, there is the cross-checking and sanction. The division that you have is essentially based on the kind of or the levels of people who are involved at each stage. So, sourcing and data collection is typically done by the sales person. He does not do any eligibility check as such. I mean, it does only a very basic eligibility check in the sense that he will not, you know, if he is given a target of, let's say, some thousand customers that he will look at on a, at a global level, he would typically not approach the payment vendor because he typically can't pay by the payment vendor because there is listed bank, not existent. So, you know, within the business profile, within the basic eligibility criteria laid down, he would try to cover a potential market segment. But he's not doing any eligibility related income collection. So, and once he sees the potential, he checks basic KYC information and contact details from their potential customer, goes back to his branch, and then typically there is either the credit person or another person from, you would say, ops or credit department who goes and visits the customer for a detailed information collection. This typically is based on a personal one-to-one discussion with the client. We will come to that in the next step also. But before that, in some entities, the sourcing officer also does a civil check at this stage itself. Whereas in some entities, we have also seen that the civil check happens at a centralized level as well. The soil sourcing also collects whatever documentation is available to support the business, simply the budget and things like that. Just to support, you know, and just to show to the brand saying that, look, he has been there for 3 years, and for the last 5 years, here are his business, here are his contacts, you can go and check him out. The next stage is actually much more detailed, and as I mentioned, in some cases, the credit officer or some other staff who is, again, separate from the sales relationship reporting line, contacts the customer, visits the business as well as the residents, conducts a personal interview with the customer and also with references regarding the services provided by the customer as well as other trade references also. And it is this guy's job to do a detailed cash flow analysis of the business. So typically, whatever information is required from that, either in terms of adjustments or in terms of lost sales within the distance, or in terms of credit sales records, which is involved in a principal case. Whatever information that you can collect, including if the customer has a bank account, then the bank account details as well, are collected to estimate what the monthly average sales looks like. So the next slide will show you how we exactly achieve this. There is one more point that we'd like to highlight here is that they use business templates. Most of the entities that we see use business templates, which are based on their experience over the years, plus also in some cases a specific market level which will then play out. To assess what are the typical margins, and sometimes also what are the typical sales levels of say one store working on the company or even the one. Or outlet working out of say time part. So typically these templates are recorded and maintained at the HO, and they are supplied to the trade officers for them to do their implementation. So I'll show you the next page. I don't know if you can see this. Can you see this? So this is completely built by Cotton ITT for a provision store. And what you typically see here is this is essentially the template margins which have come from the HO based on their research. And based on these margins, the trade officer analyzes margins over here. This is something we would have verified. The monthly sales is something you have typically verified in the case of a provision store from the selling sales record. Typically a normal provision store does not maintain any records for its cash sales, but it maintains a sort of notebook for the credit sale. With the customer's name on the account, and then you have to see credits going out to its net off at the end of every month. So that is total for a particular month, and assuming some kind of estimate is 30% or 50% of the sales are within, they arrive at what the total monthly sales. Then most kirana shops also have bills for the stock purchases that they do, especially the FMCG stock purchases that they do. They would not have bills for the loose stock purchases that they do, say rice, vegetables, ghee, and all that. They would not typically have. But for FMCG purchases, they would typically have the sales bills. So based on these two mix of information, they arrive at what the monthly income of the business would be, and it's on this that they apply their IRR or whatever the policy is. In some cases, they also deduct no cash outflows as I mentioned earlier. They are taking loans, do their loans, and then that is discovered or similar, or they can apply them also, which is as the customer research will be, and that is also deduct. So, but typically, the credit officer or the branch guys do not approve of the case, they may recommend the case. They might fill up the suggested loan side of the case, but they do not approve of the case. What you see in most entities is that the sanction, the final sanction happens either at the adoption or at the subdivision reserve kind of level. And this was a dark principle of, having negative cash and negative cash and possibly process. There is a certain check that is done on the case, which function will make it. So this is the HO part that I'm talking about. The credit manager or the head credit or the whatever designation, he typically cross checks the business cash flows as well as in some cases does the credit verification with the customer itself and some external checks as well. This is again not in all cases, but in some cases. They might also visit in person. And this also specifically happens if, let's say the business that they are looking at is a one-time business. For example, in the case that I told you, which I showed you earlier, this is a provision store template which they have things defined. And actually, this is a calculation sheet that they use. This is an Excel sheet which they have sent to us. If you convert it to media, I'm showing you media. They don't have templates like this for all the businesses that they work in. For example, one business that we visit is a pictures manufacturer. We have a huge yard where he makes mango pickles. That's where he has a warehouse. So real knowledge, nanos and makes nano metals and supplies them to models. Again, you know, he doesn't have any changes. He doesn't have any automation also. So what the entity did in this case was that he had some kind of rough purchases for the fossil type metals. And based on that, they estimated, you know, what is the unit sales and what is the margin that he makes compared to different other similar suppliers as well as others, and what is the purchase that they do and at what price, and then arrive at this money. So in this particular case, for example, in the particular case which I mentioned to you, the credit had probably, the issue was supposed to be the investor before you can finance it. Because they did not accept the money and take in place for this particular business. And then the HO credit guy decides the loan amount and the EMI or, you know, the tenor of the loan based on the company's specified IRR ratio. Now, one thing I have not mentioned here in this process is what happens if this is a secured loan. So, the film is an example of secured loan, only where entity can be taking a mortgage, an equitable mortgage as a security. In that case, what will happen is that, of course, you know, there will be a separate legal certificate which looks at all the entity and the property itself. But then, the other factor that gets added on the income assessment is the loan evaluation. So the property is only valued at second, and you have an entity policy of not more than 50% of it. And then you want to be a loan that's been required. So the loan size is then the set of principles which are lower off, you know, in a LBE or property. So that's one different. Over to Abhishek, let's do the details.
But Google's just able to do some of the operations that we visit on the ground. We visit close to 8 or 9 organizations on the ground, and we've done a diligence on it, which include both the small business loan and the affordable housing finance kind of institutions. What we have discussed is, I'm going to take you through 4 organizations. All of them are doing, all of them are in the business of lending to small businesses, and the intention is to just take you through maybe the basic structure of the organization and how it follows the process that Bhargav just explained. This is one of those organizations which has come into existence in the last, I think, 3 years. They started off with microfinance and then, but livelihood focus microfinance, but then they decided they could afford to focus entirely on the small business segment. So what they do now is completely, it's not microfinance at all. So if you look at their product, just to give you an idea of their product that they offer, we have a product, both the unsecured and the secured versions of the small business loan. So up to about 60,000 rupees, they have an unsecured product. So you know, between 30 and 60,000 rupees, they have an unsecured product. And that also, you know, there's a split between what kind of tenures are that the products are for. So, see, for 30 to 45,000, the tenure is a maximum of 24 months, and beyond that, 40 to 60,000, the tenure could be up to, you know, 24 months to 30 months. The secured product again is anywhere between 60,000 to 10 lakhs. And the tenure again is between 24 to 60. So, once again, as far as unsecured is concerned, you know, as you would see, there is security, and under the security, we mentioned that there is a hypothecation of stock or cattle or even equipment or whatever. But what we are considering, but for all practical purposes, what we are saying is that this is more of an unsecured loan. You know, if you are doing a hypothecation on a cattle, there's barely anything that you can actually do as far as taking possession of secured security is concerned. So though it is technically is some sort of security, but then for our practical purposes, we are considering it. Again, if you look at stock, you know, it's very difficult to kind of say that you have to maintain next level of stock, and whenever you default, I'm going to take charge over the stock. So for our practical purposes, we are kind of considering this kind of a loan as an unsecured loan, though it is very different from the normal microfinance loan, where there is no absolutely no security at all. Again, compared to that, just to give you a comparison, secured, like I just said, is essentially a mortgage backed product. So you take a loan and for that I take mortgage of your property.
Have they not looked at any other option of securing the unsecured loans?
Yeah, so as of now, we didn't see any example of like insurance policies and all of that. We haven't seen a case where they're funded. As far as security is concerned, they're entirely bound with you. All the guidance we saw, as far as security is concerned, they are looking at property. But yes, that's an area to consider. So again, for the lower size loan, they do cash collections, and for the higher size loan, they do PDCs. One more interesting thing that we've seen across organizations is all these guys are actually taking repayments with PDCs, except for the very small size loans. So, like I said, in other words, it actually means that the kind of customer profile that we're looking at is slightly different from the hardcore microfinance, super remote rural kind of customer. In cases where there are no bank accounts and the customer cannot furnish PDCs, in those cases even, we have seen cases where the customers are asked to open bank accounts and then they lose business. So having gone through that, if you look at, this will give you a broad idea, but this is not like, this is how it has to be, but then again, let's have a look at the organization structure. So if you look at, I'm not looking at the entire organization structure, but I'm looking at just the, what I've put on the slide here is essentially the branch level or the, customer interface level approval process as such. So the slightly darker boxes are essentially people who have, the color shading of the boxes are essentially to indicate the incentive policy, whether the person has an incentive based on the volume of the business or not. So the darker colored slides are people who have the incentive based on volume. So these guys have the incentive to push more volumes of business as possible. The slightly less darker guys on the credit side, like I mentioned, the credit officer, these guys have no incentive based on volume. They might have the performance based incentives and all of that, but that is not linked to the volume of the business, but that is more of satisfactory performance and all of that. So we are going to follow the same color coding on the slides that we come up with.
Recently, you looked at the comparison of data limits for secured and unsecured loans.
They are different.
Is there any wide variation or?
Not very different.
Because the advantage of having a secured loan from the perspective of the lender and the unsecured loan.
In metastasis itself, for example, the unsecured loan goes up to 29%.
Okay.
And the secured loan goes up to
22%. So it's actually a function of both the loan size and the security rules.
Okay. And then the processing charges are getting into that.
Yeah, that's also there.
But we didn't find a kind of a thumb rule or anything to say that the unsecured has been priced at this, and so that we didn't get.
That means there is no mechanism of pricing it based on delinquency and risk?
So this is a fairly new organization.
Yeah.
I think over a period
of time. I'm talking about it.
If you look at the few of the points that Thalia discussed in the previous slides regarding the key features of the model, if you look at in-house origination for certain things, and one default assumption that we can take on all the organizations that we have discussed today, what we have seen on the ground is that everybody has an in-house origination. Nobody is depending on external agents to fetch business or to get business. As far as separation of business and credit is concerned, as you can see, at the branch level, they have the relationship manager, the branch manager who have business targets, and the credit officer and the rest of the credit team which does not have business volume based incentives. Just to give you an idea of the process, let me go in a bit deeper. So the initial fetching of information on the customer details is done by the customer relationship manager. Each guy is responsible for getting the business into the system. He collects basic data, comes back to the branch, basic data which would include who the customer is, what does he do, KYC, all that basic information, and he comes back and gives the information to the officer at the branch, who then keys in the data and sends it to the HO, wherein it is checked for civil, these guys use quick device, easy task. So if you look at specifically Vistar, a lot of the unsecured customers actually do possibly be, you know, the microfinance type customers as well. They check the credit bureau ratings wherever available, wherever not available, they look at the documents or whatever the cash flow analysis is done. So once that report comes back to the branch saying that this is what the report is on the customer, the branch manager, they have gone through a modification process. So till about a few months back, what they used to do is up to the loan of 40,000 rupees, they used to send the branch manager to do a cash flow analysis and verification of the customer. But what interestingly they have done over, I think, last 4 months or 4 or 5 months, is they have removed the branch manager completely from the approval picture. And they have put a separate credit officer in the branch to do the appraisal process, basic appraisal process. So what happens is that once the credit officer receives the credit bureau information, he goes to the customer's place, does a verification of whatever document data was submitted by the relationship manager. He also does a cash flow analysis to understand what the business is like and how the cash flows are. And based on that, he recommends for a loan. Now, the interesting thing is that what happens is that, you know, up to a certain level for the unsecured loan, the call gets taken depending on the size and the complexity of the loan at the cluster or the branch level. If it is beyond 60,000, in that case, the files have to come to the head office to get approvals. Without the head offices or the credit heads involvement, none of those files get passed. In case of the low size ticket products, the files get passed, but then on a random basis, some of the files are checked at the head office. If you look at these main key points in the model, so as far as separate business credit that exists, there is a local knowledge, all the guys are local. Cash flow analysis is done, templarization, so before they launch any particular product, what they actually do is they study that business in its entirety and understand, and they actually come up with a template. So say for a Poha making unit, they would actually go there, sit down, the product guys would actually go there, sit down, understand everything for the business, what the source of cash flows, you know, how much padding, how much poha is going to come out and things like that, you know, just a broad range. So they get a sense of all of that and they put that into the template, which is then shared with on the field team. These guys ensure that they don't go and handle or give a loan for a new business if that business has not been covered by the current yet. So if there is a completely new business, the higher level, the HO level staff actually come down and for the first case, and they do the evaluation themselves to develop the template, and only then after that, if there is a new process, new customer that comes up for the same business, only then is branch allowed to take a part of that. Again, IRR policy is followed at multiple levels of check, as you can see, you know, if it's a depending on the loan size, what happens is, initial documentation is collected by one guy, somebody else is actually going and checking whether the documents are correct and doing the cash flow analysis. Depending on the loan size, if it's a high size loan, it has to go through two levels of checks at least. So that is where it also, you know, agrees with this particular idea of multiple checks. Going into the next organization, this is called the Indian School Finance Company.
How long is that process from origination to actually finance?
So these guys take, 14 days. 14 to 20 days. Again, Indian School Finance Company is a very interesting case where they do financing for affordable private schools only. The financing is for some form of an infrastructure build-up. So you either construct another floor or you bring in computers or you extend the construction building and things like that. What they have again is, you know, two types of products, unsecured and secured. The unsecured product is limited to 4 lakhs and the secured product is 4 lakhs and above. again, more or less the same thing. Interestingly, what since we do have some experience in doing school loans ourselves, one interesting thing that we noticed was that as far as the security part of the school is concerned, they were eliminated it by taking residential property mortgage. So, whoever the promoter is, they won't get the deal of getting the trust, school trust involved. They take a mortgage on the promoter's property. Even if it again is through PDCs. So just to give it, again, if you look at the branch level, you would see a relationship manager, a team leader, a branch manager, and a credit committee, and there are operations guys. So just to give an idea of the process.
What is the address of the company?
So, typically,
where are the operations
normally? So, the relationship manager typically goes, he is a guy who has got the job of getting business in the system. He essentially identifies people. At the school level, and goes on and collects the basic data, KYC, details about the school, the permission, the recognition. So they have a set bunch of criteria there again, you know. Like everybody else, as far as one critical thing that we have seen in all these cases is that even in the small business, generally small business category, there are a set of basic criteria that people have to follow. It's like, you know, the guy has to be in business, same business for 3 years, 5 years, and things like that, just to build an experience for the story. So they also get the recognition certificate. They need recognition, they also they need to ensure that the recognition is there from a particular state level or a central level school registration authority or whatever relevant that might be. That is taken into picture. Then there is a depending on number of students also they take a call. And then the, how many of the school has been in operation. So I think they have a limit of 5 years that the school has to be in existence for the year round. So there are a bunch of these criteria which are taken into account, and then the relationship manager collects all the documents, all these documents, number of students, just take a look at the registration book, how many students are studying, what is the fee structure like from class say 1 to 10, whatever fee structure looks like. So basically, he collects all the information regarding the potential job flows and KYC, and then comes back to the office. The team leader who was kind of reporting also as a relationship manager, he would essentially go through those documents. So there are any doubts, any questions he asks. He gets back to the customer, potential customer, and then speaks and gets clarifications on if there is a doubt. Post that, what happens is that these guys have developed a kind of a software. It's a basic software, but then what it does essentially is that you key in all the data. And regarding the school's cash flows, and it shows up the numbers saying that, you know, this particular school with this kind of cash flows can be eligible for a loan of amount X, can you not buy it and all that. So, that is the kind of really high level of sophistication on the advertising side. So, that is done, but the result is known that school F can get loan Y for tenure X or tenure Z. And then what happens is, one of the members of the, so they have this concept called the credit committee. What that consists of is the business head, the head of the branch head, the risk head, and the operations head. All these guys sit with, are part of the credit committee. They sit down and they essentially analyze each case before the promise sanction. So before the credit committee discussion happens, what happens is one of the credit committee members, which typically would be a branch manager or any of the other guys also, you know, can actually visit, would actually visit the customer on his school, will see what the school is like, what it does, how many students there are, get a pure feel of what it is like, verifies whatever data was submitted was correct or not. They would come back and then the credit committee discussion would happen and then the call would be taken.
So here, just to add to this, a branch manager is different from a normal microfinance manager.
So the brand manager is typically an MBA from a medium good school and I was from 5-6 years. In fact, Nanda is from a good school and has 7 years of experience. So it's like a Brahmana, it's like you can say that it's like a Brahmana or a proper bank, you know, almost.
In that case, see, essentially these type of schools are actually in the form of a trust. So you say that these guys want expertise of going through the trust documents and
No, so they, as far as security is concerned, they don't go in that direction at all.
Oh.
They are taking security of the
independent security arch out.
And they are also lending to the promoter.
Okay, something like a third party security.
Not third party, they are lending to the promoter.
No, the thing is that the property doesn't belong to the
school. It doesn't belong to the school. Security is given by the promoter in his personal capacity. That's why he is saying that.
So, yeah.
And normally, what is the how much is the this company's experience will be about 5 years, that means how many years itself?
Analyzing these problems before giving a loan. This is possibly, you know, it's possible because they are not that huge yet. Beyond the point, some level of decentralization or something would possibly happen. We don't know. I'm not saying that we are going to do it, but possibly it might happen, it may not happen. Both sides, both ways. So again, one thing that I have done to address that.
See, as a member, usually when power is 0 or as high as 10%, so that is because we have 60 cases a default. But as it went further up to power 180, it came down to
190.
So, the origination of the house. The business and the credit guys and the people taking the call, the credit guys are different from the business guys. Local knowledge, yes, the guys are from the local area, and the relationship managers can be from the local area. Templates, yes, what is much easier to do this on this particular place with all schools. So they essentially have this thing of, you know, class-wise, how many students there are, and all the things. It's much more simple compared to the other guys. So they have a complete IR policy is there. There are multiple levels of check as we saw. There is a team leader, non manager. There's also an operations story that happens here who operations guys check whether the documents are there. So, and then obviously the credit. We go to the next. This here is mass financial services.
So, all the entities who want to come out, right? They also
This is mass financial services. This is a, you know, these are the old granddads of kind of small business. The interesting thing is that they are more closer to coming from. They are closer to the microfinance thing. In the sense that their loan size is much smaller. They do enter to 50 to 75 thousand, so you can say that they are very similar to microfinance. There, again, they have an interesting model. They have a cap on the upper loan size, but what they do is on the at the branch level, what they have is people call it feet on street. These guys are essentially people who bring in business and they collect very basic level of data. that's essentially, they have a target of, you know, getting X number of customers on board. So what they do is they go around, talk to people, and they collect all the basic information and bring it back and submit it to some other branch. What happens after that is the credit officer, whenever the lead is entered, the credit officer then gets so the next step is that once the data comes in, depending on the lead, the operations officer actually goes out and collects, reads the customer and collects more data as is required by the process. So this guy collects the entire set of data, cashflow related documentation, all of that, and brings it back. The credit officer then goes and does the cash flow analysis, understands what the capital of the business are, where it's there, so that's what they're doing. And having understood the business and what the cash flows are, he filters the file and sends it across the picture. They have a complete centralized approval for small business. So that is very interesting because these guys are operating across
three states.
And they are fair.
But
their whole portfolio is 600 crore. Of this,
600 crore.
Of this, their SME's portfolio is something about 2 million.
So there are multi business
of many years they are in this business. 2 million.
So that's the other interesting thing. Now, like I said,
is it a limited company?
What is their dimensions? What is their credit risk? How much you need their department?
Their overall PAR 90, you don't have a product type number, everything. Overall PAR 90 is somewhere around
2%.
And PAR, starting with write-off service in less than a
month. Of course, sir.
They're not starting with this company. They are direct investment. You know, equity from RKC or also,
and
FMO.
So, I mean, I think this is one of the organizations that we saw, you know, very early, very shallow on this.
What is the cost of credit?
That's the only one. I think, see, they have consortium arrangement with many banks.
So, what is the, they charge that?
So, they charge, for the SME loan, it goes up to 27%, 21%. They also do everything for the same. But the rest of the portfolio is missing. Nothing they can buy for the
10%. So again, these guys essentially meet all the investment criteria, except for the interesting thing that they don't have published templates. They do follow the process, it's all in the head, they don't have published templates on the businesses.
So in fact, on the audit entities, the more advanced that we formed on the index side is this one. They have actually set up a separate team whose only job is to go around with having the
tech product.
And when they study a business, they are common architecture, they study the entire region. Starting from where it goes to the raw rights from, going up to where they have their skill contact. And what are the margins that they
see? And do they have tech?
There's a, you know, our information that we can put in the software.
And then they have a software registration
equipment. All the things are already coming up. They have their own, all of these guys have their own thing.
I have got a phone in there.
So they have a lot of
things. Okay. See, we go to the next interesting case of Equitas. This is one, it is on microfinance. This is the Equitas commercial vehicles. This is that we're talking about.
Is it a division or is it part of
the company? It's a separate company.
Separate company.
So, I mean, just to give you a brief context, so when we had decided to do the small business loans, we were looking at the entire set of small businesses that and financing that was happening, and we had initially thought that, you know, our understanding was that a commercial vehicle is also, because this is another small enterprise thing, we could possibly classify and understand our small business lending underwriting guidelines. So the IT would obviously know, it's obvious that if we could go on a set of organization, we could have a set of underwriting guidelines. So we had that in mind, and then we went on the ground and did a diligence on them. Interestingly, we realized that they did not, you know, match with a lot of the underwriting guidelines. So, you know, like I've been talking about all these organizations, which in some sense, yeah, everybody kind of is an okay organization from our side. We do not, we kind of stop as well as this organization. We do not go ahead with the transaction that we do.
So, as of now, we don't have a credit committee for this business. What we actually do is we have to develop underwriting guidelines for reading plans. So, we need to get a very different background. And we want to use
the credit.
Yeah, they have brought into the small business category.
So they have a very unique process. What they have is, at the branch level, they have a sales officer who brings in the business. One interesting thing I just see is across this thing, everybody has the same color, nobody has the same. This is an interesting thing. You find me because they are new, they started off in June this year, last year. But if you look at the volume, they've gone to, I think, 60 crores by numbers. They've grown like a lot of district places in 6 days. And in 6 days. That's
a day?
6 days. 6 days.
6 days. But what is the average cost of credit? They charge the volume, sorry, the more cost of
19 to 20. So, what happens in the sales officer essentially brings in clients, so the basic documentation, the KYC, other details, bank account details, and all that is collected by the sales officer. It is brought to the branch and submitted. What happens then is there is a kind of a operations person who sits in the office who does a telephonic check as in whether you exist, whether that is necessary or not. So then what happens is that a credit officer will go and verifies whatever documents are being submitted, plus that person also does a viability, what we call a viability report, which is essentially a kind of a proxy cash flow analysis thing. It's essentially just to get a broad idea as to how much cash flows could be possible. There is not too much of a rigor in that analysis as we have seen here. In fact, there is very little. So, we would take that, you know, for a particular type of vehicle, X is possibly income that will be related, so it will be
It's actually based on the integrated driver gain rate for the vehicle.
So, but one thing that is very, once the credit officer brings in cash flow related, viability related, or the vehicle related information that is handed over to the credit manager, and in looking at what I was saying, because this is a vehicle hypothecation story, there is a technical, you know, the technical evaluation of vehicle evaluation and all that is done by a local paneled technical evaluator, and the history of the vehicle is checked through things like, you know, those RC books and the extracts and stuff. So all that is checked, and the credit manager then takes a call. So the interesting story in this whole model is that all the decisions are taken on the ground level. None of it goes above. If side of the story is that though what these guys have done is they have templatized everything, you know, from each and every vehicle that they want to finance, what value that vehicle is going to, you know, be eligible for a loan for, you know, a 1-year-old vehicle, a 2-year-old, or a 3-year-old, or a 15-year-old vehicle. They have templatized all of that, the specific values mentioned. For different types of customers, we have recognized that all the possible potential type of customers that are there, and mentioned maximum loan caps on each category. So they have a very, you know, well defined eligibility criteria and loan size definition. So based on that, the credit manager would take a call. Like if it is within the, you know, the template, he doesn't need to speak to anybody, just takes the approval. But if there is a deviation of any sort, in that case it has to go to the next level depending on the deviation size. If you go back to this set of criteria or parameters that we are looking at in-house origination, these guys also are in in-house origination. Business and credit is separate, obviously, but local knowledge is cash flow analysis. Like I said, you know, there is barely any cash flow analysis done. Kind of a proxy capture of what kind of capital could be possible for our driver listening to. Templates, yes, this is possibly one of the highest templatization that we've seen, but not income. Not exactly income templatization, but on the asset side. This is more on the templatization, on the asset side. So IRR concepts also do not look to be, because there are no cash flow analysis to it. IRR concept also doesn't seem to be very important on that check. Multiple of levels of check, yes. So you know, having after having gone through this and the capitalizations and all that we've seen, what we realize is that we said that you know, we didn't feel that there is too fits into our criteria of small business, you know, essentially because of that. The other is more of asset finance story, that is here. And it was going to be difficult for us to categorize it within the small business loan category and then talk about the transaction. What we decided to do essentially is look at commercial vehicle finance, and this is you know a little more tricky because we are going to use commercial vehicle finance, we are not going to use commercial vehicle finance. So we actually decided to sit down and you know, go through on this one, look at the commercial vehicle finance, use commercial vehicle finance, commercial vehicle briefly, and then once we have an understanding, we have an underwriting guidelines, and then go ahead with these. Because you know, out of all the stuff that we are doing, commercial vehicle finance is actually a big trend that is established in the market. It's much easier to do transaction today rather than today, maybe compared to a small business transaction. So we are going to do this, but since we don't understand the business, we said put this on hold, and we are going to do this possibly we have a next financial investment. We can manage to understand the business. So these are the businesses that we saw. Like I said, it all these organizations seem to have found the right model to finance, provide access to finance for people who don't have access to finance for banks. But then even then we find problems like you know how you get loan to a temporary place. There are no documents around it. How do you give loans to somebody who is essentially dealing in scrap, a scrap dealer? No documents either side. So what we interestingly saw is that you know these organizations are slowly developing ways and needs to even evaluate that. Because I mean, to be very frank, scrap dealers are possibly one of the richest guys on the planet in certain areas, and they don't have bank accounts. So temple priests again are rich people or whatever you call it. So what, and just to give an example of a temple piece, what we've seen in some places, so these are questions that keep coming up. So just to give an example of how temple piece story happening better is what we saw was that, you know, what we came to know is that temple piece with that guy is, you know, employed with a temple, there is a particular amount of salary that he gets. If that guy goes and does puja at, you know, people's house, for every type of puja, there is a certain amount that is, you know, from market practice. So they have a sense of all of that, and then they use that to evaluate. They take references of customers, they go and speak to the customer whether this guy comes in or not with their money. So that's how they get a kind of a sense. We know the calendar, Indian calendar, it has pujas all over the place, so they get a sense of that depending on the local geography as to what the pujas are done. So you know that is how they're trying to factor even though there are no documents available. How do you avoid willful default? You know, because how do you avoid willful default? That again is another big question because you don't have a sense of what the customer is. So cash flow wise, whether the repayment capability, as far as the repayment capability is concerned, these guys are already doing. As far as willful default is concerned, I think a bunch of things that these people are doing is one, there is a big, a lot of stress on the relationship. There is also this thing of you know, certain negative criteria that I said. Just to give an example, a very funny negative criteria that I found was unmarried males were not preferred to work in some of these organizations. So, you know, there are negative businesses that are there. So, in particular areas, they would not be financed. There are negative areas, localities which would not get financed. So, that is how they are kind of in some ways. Taking care of the default issues. Some of the organizations even what they do is when they take a customer, they actually get an existing customer as a reference or as a guarantor in some sense. So that is also a way in which they do it. We have a next question, what kind of templates are needed? You know, like you saw, some guys are super detailed on the template side. Some people are not really so template based. They haven't been ahead of this somehow. According to us, there should be a kind of a middle path. We can't completely do away with templates. There is a need for some sort of template, especially when the business grows up to some extent. But then you can't find everything, every decision to a template. Otherwise, what might actually end up happening is that your three business guys would actually look up data and make it look like we can fit your template somehow. So there has to be a middle path, and then the organization is large. What you see in a lot of these cases is that there is a lot of centralization as far as credit issues are concerned. So what would happen when the organization is blown out? How do you decentralize the credit decision power, and also another thing that we see over some time? Some of the organizations like Mars have been existing for 100 years, 20 years or so, but they have a centralized credit. And it's a very difficult thing to imagine that millions of people are working around all the past years with centralized credit. So there is one of a mix of both. There is no right or wrong choice in getting better management. That's where we are. Thanks for the questions.
For the Q&A.
We answered all the ideal questions.
Feedback on your way. Thanks. Fantastic. I'll turn it off.